In our last class, we revealed how and why the orthodontic movement manifests in face. For this movement to occur safely and effectively, the only variable that we orthodontists can and should control is the orthodontic force. Perhaps that's why some authors compare the search for the ideal force to the search for the Holy Grail, as if our greatest problems were solved if we knew the exact force values for each movement. Do these values really exist? And what does ideal force in orthodontics mean? These answers and other relevant information on the subject form the topic of today's lecture.
The classic concept of optimal force was proposed by Schwarz in 1932 when describing that the optimal force would be the one capable of altering tissue pressure without occluding the blood vessels of the periodontal ligament. According to him, force below this level would not induce tooth movement, whereas forces above this level would provoke areas of tissue necrosis, which would hamper movement until undermining resorption removes necrotic tissues. At present, this concept has been expanded to the force capable of provoking the maximum of the biological response so as to provide a fast and painless movement, with no side effects such as exaggerated mobility and roof resorption. I think it's interesting to review one of the first studies in humans that sought to identify the optimum range of force for tooth movement. The authors evaluated 9 patients undergoing premolar extraction and found that the canines moved rapidly to the extraction sites when the value of the applied force was in the range of 150 to 250 grams. With force below 150 grams, the canines practically did not move. And with force in the range of 400 to 600 grams, those who moved were the posterior teeth, while the canine remained relatively stable. These results led to the idea of the differential force concept, in which a range of optimal force values to obtain the maximum tooth movement could be found. This statement may be true, but certainly, the optimum values found in the small number of patients in Smith and Story's work do not apply to the general population. This is what subsequent research has shown, that is, the optimal values are individualized. You can do experiments on rats, cats, pigs, dogs, rabbits, monkeys, and humans, and the results of optimum force will be similar. That is, the inter-individual differences are more important than the magnitude of the force. Take, for example, this classic study on dogs. This research evaluated the influence of several magnitudes of force on the amount of dental movement. Notice in dog 1, for example, that doubling the force did not change the amount of movement obtained. Something similar occurred in dog 2. In which the tooth movement obtained was the same even with the force being increased 4 times. Also notice in this graphic the enormous difference of movement observed between dogs 1 and 2, independently of the intensity of the applied force. That is, the individual variability in the application of force was much more relevant than the magnitude of these forces. It's no coincidence that even after many decades of research on the subject, scientific evidence does not support the existence of specific numerical values that are optimal for tooth movement. The fact that there's no cookbook recipe with the optimal numeric values for tooth movement makes it necessary to hold even more knowledge, care, and control over the force that we apply. There are some guidelines in the literature on force values for specific movements. Tables like this are interesting as an initial guide to understand that the force considered ideal will depend on a number of factors, such as the type of movement desired. In the translational movement, for example, a force of 100 grams can be indicated, as this force will distribute in a larger area of the periodontal ligament. For the intrusion movement, a much lower force is usually indicated, as 10 grams. Since, in this case, the distribution of this force will concentrate on a smaller area of the ligament, therefore favoring the generation of greater pressure in the region, even with light forces. I consider that, as specialists, we need to understand the variables of the orthodontic force very clearly in order to provide the best for our patients. Let us see then the three important variables of the orthodontic force from the biological point of view. These are the magnitude or intensity, the duration, and the frequency of application. I believe that the most relevant variable for the orthodontist is the magnitude of the force, since it's the one over which we have greater possibility of control. Considering the biological aspect, we have three zones of force values with distinct biological response. Very low values are not sufficient to trigger orthodontic movement, whereas very high values can cause significant compression of the ligament vessels with consequent formation of areas of yellinization and greater risk of roof resorption. In an intermediate range, which would be the optimal zone, we have the force that causes the maximum movement with minimal damage to the tissues. Theoretically, the term light is used for forces that are within this range. But as we will see below, it's very difficult to establish the difference between a light and a heavy force. We have already pointed out these concepts are related to several factors. If we go back to the table of values of profit, we will see that a force of 50 grams would be so light as to be innocuous for a translation, for example. However, 50 grams for an intrusion can be considered a heavy force, since the force distribution is concentrated in a smaller area. The time has come to understand that stresses and strains induced by forces are more relevant than their values. Without entering into the exact concepts of these terms, let us use a simple analogy so that you can understand this question. Imagine a force of 100 grams being applied to a finger using a needle with a cap. Now imagine applying the same force intensity, 100 grams, using the needle without the cap. Obviously, in the second case, the pressures, stresses, and strains causing the cells of my finger will not be the same. The needle without a cap will certainly cause greater damage and tissue strains. Comparing this with the teeth and the scenario of orthodontic movement, the same happens. If we apply a force considered light, such as 25 grams, in a more smooth and homogeneous alveolar ligament bone interface, this force will probably not cause much damage and tissue strains, and it's therefore considered light from the biological aspect. However, if the same force is applied in a more irregular and rough ligament bone interface, for example, the tissue strains will be larger. So this force can be considered heavy in this situation. The fact is that we apply forces in an extremely complex and still scarcely known scenario, which is the alveolar bone periodontal ligament interface. We have repeated this information several times in our classes because of its high relevance. That is, the reality is that even controlling the intensity of applied force, we are not able to apply purely light and optimal force considering its biological aspect. It's necessary to understand that the impact of force magnitude on tissue response depends on the number of factors, such as roof size and morphology, support tissue conditions, local cell population, and the ability of cellular responses to adapt to these stimuli. Imagine the application of a 30 grams intrusive force on an incisor with normal bone support. Would the application of this same force to a tooth with periodontal problems cause the same biological response? Of course not. Perceive this analysis on the tensile strains causing the periodontal ligament, in which we simulate several degrees of loss of alveolar bone. Note that the application of the same force of 30 grams caused completely different strains according to the loss of bone support. The greater the loss of alveolar bone, the greater the strain caused in the periodontal ligament. This is why force magnitude is only a factor to be considered, and this factor is relative and must be individualized according to each particular case, respecting all those variables that directly influence the biological response obtained. It's worth to emphasize that the increase of the force with the purpose of accelerating the orthodontic movement does not have scientific basis. Increasing the force to accelerate the movement usually causes problems such as increased rotations, loss of anchorage, and loss of control of the desired movements. So the tip is, do not use increased force as a resource to accelerate your movement. If you perceive an excessive slowness in a movement, I suggest you investigate the presence of some mechanical obstacle to it, such as the interference of a neighboring or antagonistic tooth, or the presence of significant occlusal forces, which can also hamper the movement. Let's speak now about the duration and frequency of applied forces. These variables usually overlap in clinical practice. Continuous are those that, in between visits, remain the same or close to the applied values. Examples are the use of superelastic coils, which, depending on the quality of the material and the degree of movement desired, may not require reactivation. Interrupted force are those that decay to zero between activations. As examples, we mention the action of loops made with steel wires. And finally, the force can also be considered intermittent, when they decrease to zero every time the patient removes the accessory or appliance. In this case, we mentioned the use of elastics, removable appliance, and extraoral appliance as examples. Theoretically, the continuous and light force are considered more physiological. However, we have already explained that the concept of light is relative. And in a certain way, in the clinical practice, no applied force is 100 continuous, since we cannot forget that besides the orthodontic force, the teeth undergo continuous stimulation of the force of chewing and swallowing, which constantly interact with the orthodontic forces. After presenting the classic variables that interfere in the biological response to orthodontic forces, I would like to highlight an issue that is still scarcely discussed in the literature, considering its high relevance. It's the control of the direction of the applied forces. The mechanical aspects of orthodontic force will be discussed in the next section of the course. But to conclude today's lecture, we will emphasize the biological importance of controlling the direction of force to the tissues receiving it. One of the most feared clinical consequences in orthodontics is roof resorption, which is usually associated with intense and/or poorly directed force. Perceive this example illustrated in the book of Professors Burston and Choi, in which an exaggerated inclination of the upper incisors to the lingual generated significant areas of compression in the ligament against the alveolar bone, favoring the roof resorption of the teeth. It's quite possible that in this case the problem hasn't been the intensity of the applied force, but the wrong direction. Let us look at another common situation in which the lack of control of the direction of forces can delay the treatment and favor roof resorption. Suppose you wish to distalize this premolar to this molar. The ideal would be to perform a translational movement to maintain the constancy of the apposition and resorption areas, so that the movement could be faster and more effective. However, we often perform this type of movement by inclination, in a way that diverse and opposite areas of resorption and apposition are created. The problem of reversing this movement, that is, performing the roof uprighting now, will involve the transformation of apposition areas into resorption ones, and vice versa. Transforming a resorptive area into apposition is usually simple. However, turning an apposition area into resorption may take longer because it only takes place after mineralization of the osteoid tissue that normally forms initially in apposition areas. In conclusion, these back and forth movements are not desired. as they extend the treatment duration and favor roof resorption. We can see that in this study performed in rats, where the teeth that suffered back and forth movements presented much more roof resorption than the teeth that hadn't undergone this movement. In summary, when analyzing the bigger picture of orthodontic movement, the main variables capable of influencing the biological process of alveolar modeling and remodeling can be divided into mechanical factors of one side, with emphasis on intensity, direction, and sense of applied forces, and systemic factors on the other side, involving cellular responses, hormones, vitamins, drugs, among others.
To recap, today we learn about some biological foundations that explain the enormous difference we observe in clinical practice. We know that pain response, degree of mobility, speed of movement, and roof resorption risks differ significantly from patient to patient. However, our obligation as specialists is to know these variables as much as possible, so that we can treat our patients in the best possible way. In our next class, we will discuss how drugs and systemic factors can interfere with our orthodontic treatment.